we get started today, we're going to turn to this afternoon looking at some of the disciplinary changes that came out of General Conference. Woo! Yay! Can you think of a better way to spend the hour after lunch? I can't. I don't know. So as we get started, we may have time for verbal questions during this session, depending on how things go and the speed of presentation and all that. But at the same time, we are wanting to use Poll Everywhere so we can catalog your questions and provide written responses to have as a resource after this event is over. If I could have the screen for Poll Everywhere. Who's familiar with that? Have you used it before? Some of you, Poll Everywhere? It's a great system. Need you to follow these instructions. We have a chat room set up called GBHEM. You can use this. You can either, if you have web access, and I know there are some connectivity issues today. Some people are able to get on, some people are not. We've reset the router over lunch, so hopefully that will take care of some of the issues. If by chance you cannot log on, please do give us written questions for us to add later on for a follow-up FAQ resource sheet after the event. To enter the chat room, text GBHEM to 22333, or you can go to the website, which is pollev.com/GBHEM. We'll have points along the way for questions, and I want, if there are a lot of questions about the discipline, I do want the chance to respond as quickly and as accurately as possible to many of those. And so what you'll do is log in, and then when you have a question, you simply need to text your answer, and we will have those scrolling across the screen and get to those as we do have time. Again, we may have some time for some verbal questions. We'll just have to see how it goes. Does everyone get an idea of how this works? You got it? Okay. Okay. You might want to note the 22333 because we're going to switch to a different slide in just a minute. I'm going to go to my presentation now. This afternoon, we're going to be discussing three things for each level of assessment. As you know, when people begin the candidacy process to move toward ordination or move toward licensing, there are many levels of assessment along the way. You begin with an application for certified candidacy to serve as a local pastor, then you seek licensing approval and continual renewal of that license, and then obviously people come to you as the board members seeking provisional membership and moving on to full membership. So what we are going to do today is talk about a few things with each level. We're going to talk about what we are assessing for at each level. For example, at candidacy, the DCOM needs to determine if a candidate is able to articulate a call to ministry and if that candidate demonstrates fitness or potential for ministry. We're also going to then identify disciplinary requirements, the main disciplinary requirements that are identified at each level of assessment, and we'll give you the relevant discipline paragraphs for you to follow up and read on your own when you have the time. And then finally, for each stage, we will be lifting up any changes that have come out of General Conference that affect board work. We'll be lifting up the changes that most affect the BOM's work, and that is mostly in the 300 paragraphs and then the 635 and the 666 paragraphs that we talked about this morning. And these are the major changes. Keep in mind that there will be other minor changes and clarifications once the new discipline is printed. And I'll remind you of my disclaimer, the discipline is not final until it's printed. We have been working with the publishing house to correct some issues with the initial draft that they sent us, and I have made some suggestions. We've made some suggestions about how we understood the legislation, some changes they need to make. The Committee on Correlation and Review decides if our comments are accurate to the delegates' thoughts on certain pieces of legislation, and so we wait to see what the final discipline says once it's printed. There is a handout in your folder today for this afternoon. It's called the Update for DCOMs and Boards of Ordained Ministry. This will be one of the things we follow, one of the resources that we follow along with as we work through today's session. While they're finding that, could you switch this monitor so I can see the text that's up on the screen? I'm seeing my video right now, so if you could, is that possible? And then I'll be joined today with colleagues from the division staff who will discuss the areas of work and legislation that are related to their portfolios. The grounding for how we assess candidates for ministry resides in the fact that at different points throughout the process, we assess for varying levels of knowledge, skills, abilities, and personal characteristics of our candidates. For example, we don't expect a new candidate to necessarily have experience in preaching or to be an expert in using pastoral leadership skills, but we do expect that a new candidate is able to articulate a call to licensed or ordained ministry and can discuss that call somewhat in light of Wesley's historic questions listed there in paragraph 310. We also believe that we are a connectional church, and that's in many ways, that not just in how we organize ourselves, but that's in our sacramental life as well. You know, when we baptize a baby, when we baptize a new member, we are bringing that person into membership, and the church agrees to raise that person in the faith. It's community. So just as an individual expresses a call to licensed or ordained ministry, we have many steps along the way where different communities must affirm and confirm that person's call. In the church, we understand that all are called to serve God through Jesus Christ by virtue of our baptism. All Christians are called into ministry, and candidacy is built upon the discernment of the ministry of all Christians. We start with that as our common base and our common understanding. Candidacy, then, or pursuing set-apart ministry for licensing and ordination, helps the conference ensure that someone who feels called to ministry also has the grace or the evidence of a call in their life and evidence of a relationship with God and Jesus Christ. We want to see that they have gifts for ministry, the talents that they bring to ministry, and the promise for their leadership. And then finally, along the way, we want to see fruit or demonstrated effectiveness in ministry. We want to see evidence of the Holy Spirit in their relationships and in their work. So it's important to keep in mind then the different levels of assessment. The candidacy process assesses for fitness or potential for licensed or ordained ministry. And then as the application process moves toward provisional membership and ordination, we expect candidates to demonstrate their readiness to serve and finally their effective in ministry when they're approaching full membership. So as a provisional member gains experience, we see them growing from being ready to take on a full-time appointment, from having a good understanding of United Methodist doctrine and polity, and learning how to work in the church or in their ministry settings, and then developing an expertise in ministry and effectiveness in their appointment settings. So we need to make sure that we are assessing for the right requirements at the correct time in the process. You want to keep your DCOMs from getting too far ahead, and you want to make sure when you get to full membership, you're seeing that this person has demonstrated effectiveness in ministry during their provisional period. As you know, we have disciplinary standards, don't we? Yes, we have a lot of them, and these are good. Additionally, many conferences add standards for candidates to complete during the process. Conferences are allowed to, and many do, add additional standards. The basic requirement of that is you can't add anything that conflicts with what the discipline already says. So, for example, some conferences require CPE of candidates. Some conferences require a certain seminary class. So things like that vary from conference to conference. The criteria for evaluating an applicant for certified candidacy is assessing their understanding of their call to ministry and their fitness to be effective in ministry in the United Methodist Church. Remember, you're assessing, does this person, they may be a great person to serve in another denomination or in another field. We're assessing for, do they fit in the United Methodist Church, and most particularly in your annual conference. The conference provides a discernment process that involves the candidate having the chance to talk and write about their call. They meet with a mentor or mentoring groups, and they meet with their district committee to articulate that call. The conference then assesses for fitness and potential through things like their background checks, their psychological assessment, checking references, and learning how candidates have already been involved in leadership in other areas of their lives. The disciplinary requirements to become a certified candidate are in paragraph 310. The requirements for continuing as a candidate until licensing or provisional membership are in paragraph 313. Some of the highlights, and these are some, I'm not naming everything. Some of the highlights include completion of high school or an equivalency standard, membership or participation in a United Methodist ministry setting for a minimum of 1 year, charge conference support, and other assessment steps like the background credit checks and psychological assessment. The annual approval for continuance requires ongoing charge conference support, educational progress, and a DCOM interview and approval. We've posted a complete list of the process steps in the BOM library too for your reference. The good thing about the candidacy process, there have not been changes to the process itself at the 2016 General Conference. However, there are three main decisions that you do need to know about. I'll refer you to the handout here for the language on that. This is probably the first one. Lay supply is the one I've started and our staff has started to receive questions about. The basic new requirement that if a lay supply person is going to serve in a pastoral setting or charge for longer than 1 year, within that year, that person will begin the process of becoming a certified lay minister or a certified candidate. And then that way, they can come under the care of the district committee. The questions, of course, are how and when do you implement this? The new discipline begins January 1, 2017, so you have lay supply serving in this situation right now. Whether you decide to start this process on July 1 of 17 and work backwards for those who are completing a year, or start with July 17 and move forward into the next year to start implementing this requirement, really is going to need to be a decision with your bishop and your cabinet, your board and your district committees to decide what kind of a roll-in makes sense for you. We know there's going to be transition time in putting this into place. And for some conferences, the number of lay supply makes this very unwieldy to roll in all at once. So work with your bishop, work with your cabinet, district committees, figure out the best way to make it happen. If I were pushed, I would say by July 1 of 2018, this should definitely be in place for all annual conferences, with some of that transition time built in. The General Conference added a new requirement. They are wanting churches to encouraging churches to financially support the candidates that they send for licensed or ordained ministry. Yeah, that's a great idea. If a church wants to support a candidate, can they also find a way to support them somewhat, a great deal, whatever amount makes sense? In some way, so out of that, of course, then we have a new form. Yeah, right? Yeah, that's great. I think I've named it Form 117 because we had 116 and, you know, I was feeling creative. So the DS then is encouraged to look at that form to thank and recognize the church for their support of their candidate and to encourage the church to provide financial support if they are not doing that for someone they endorse for a candidacy. So your DCOM committee members are going to have to track that as a part of the renewal process for candidates. I believe the hope is that this will benefit the candidates if we can encourage our churches to support them financially. I hope there will be some benefit for that for our candidates. And then finally, the language on translation. The DCOM through the BOM shall seek ways to consider cultural and ethnic racial realities and language translations as candidates meet these requirements, including interviews, psychological assessment, criminal background, and credit checks. at candidacy particularly, you are dealing with some candidates who are new to the United States or do not have English as their first language. Background checks and credit checks in different countries are a different reality than or different standard or different process than what we have in the United States. And finally, the delegates have permitted that translation should and is allowed during those interview times. Okay. I'm going to introduce Shannon. Shannon, you met her early, is our Assistant General Secretary for Clergy Formation. She works with local pastors, course of study, and she's going to talk to you about some of these things today. Yeah.
Hello, good afternoon. I'm sorry to be here at the coveted after lunch time. Yes, I will not take it personally if you all doze off in the middle of what I'm saying. It is my privilege to support the course of study and the ministry of licensed local pastors and associate members, and I'd like to share with you a little bit about this. The criteria for evaluation criteria for a local pastor, first, at the time of the initial license, the criteria would be that the person is a certified candidate who has articulated a call to serve and is ready to serve as a full-time or part-time local pastor or a student local pastor in an appointment setting. There's also an ongoing licensing process, so that evaluation is ongoing. The pastor must meet the standards for effectiveness that have been set up by the Board of Ordained Ministry and the Cabinet. And that effectiveness is evaluated for that particular appointment setting that the local pastor is in. The requirements for receiving a license for pastoral ministry can be found in paragraph 315 and 316, list the responsibilities and duties of those who are licensed. Before receiving the first license, someone must become a certified candidate, must complete the orientation to ministry, must complete licensing school, must receive DCOM approval, BOM recommendations, and clergy session approval. So all of that to receive the first license, and then be appointed. And then they receive their license. To continue that license requires approval from the DCOM each year, and Board of Ordained Ministry and clergy session approval each year as well. In addition, they must complete the educational requirements, such as if they have not had credit for that, such as course of study. The license requires an appointment. So if there is no appointment, there is no license. There were a number of General Conference decisions that affected and concerned local pastors. One of the first ones is the expansion of the course of study. This legislation, which will be found in paragraph 324.6C, allows for course of study to be embedded in a bachelor's degree in United Methodist-related colleges and universities. Now, this legislation was designed to meet the needs of people, particularly second career folks, who had not had the opportunity to receive a bachelor's degree, but desired to go on to provisional membership. For many of them, the requirements of being in pastoral ministry, perhaps being bivocational, doing course of study, and trying to obtain a bachelor's degree, it was just more than could be borne. And so we wanted to allow some flexibility and greater access to the educational requirements for provisional membership through the course of study process, and this would allow for that. I can tell you, I have had a number of people, as particularly United Methodist colleges and universities, contact me about this legislation. We are working on an implementation policy. What I've stressed with them and I want to stress with you is that course of study in an undergraduate degree still requires that the person be a licensed local pastor under appointment. This is not designed for the 18-year-old who thinks that they are called to ordained ministry and wants to explore that. Unless you'd like to give them an appointment as a licensed local pastor, then they're certainly able to do that. But course of study is for licensed local pastors, and so that degree would be for them as well. We are also asking that the degree make sure to respect and include the contextual nature of learning in the course of study, and to respond to that as well. And you'll be hearing more about that through the end of the year as we roll that out as well. Another change in the Book of Discipline following General Conference is to replace the provisional membership age requirement for those who are seeking provisional membership through the licensed local pastor course of study route. Instead of the 40-year years of age requirement, it replaces that age requirement with a 4 years of full-time service or its equivalent requirement. So as long as you have completed the educational requirements for course of study with advanced course of study and you have the equivalent of 4 years of full-time service, you could enter into the provisional membership process. Another piece of legislation clarifies that the elected fellowship chair shall be a member of the Board of Ordained Ministry and its executive committee, but that the chair may be a full-time or part-time local pastor who have completed course of study. It also clarified or added that the advanced course of study must include all of the basic graduate theological studies. Previously, advanced course of study had to only include half of those. Now, all of the BGTS must be credited to the advanced course of study in order for it to be completed in course of study, advanced course of study. There are a number of other bits of legislation that affect local pastors and course of study, and if you want further detail about that, I'm happy to talk with you about that, and we'll be talking about that in my workshop later. But those are the major General Conference decisions that affected local pastors. Thank you.
One thing I did want to say before we move to the provisional membership and then some issues affecting deacons, clarify that local pastors are clergy members. This is one place where conferences tend to get hung up. People, to get to provisional membership, from the time they're a certified candidate to the time they get to provisional membership, your standard kind of candidate, seminary student progressing, who is not serving as a local pastor, has 12 years to make it to provisional membership. Once someone becomes a local pastor, they are a clergy member of your annual conference. And as long as they are serving under appointment, they are a clergy member. So the 12-year candidacy clock does not apply to them. A local pastor can serve 15, 18, 20 years and then decide to go to provisional membership, and they will not have expired that certified candidacy clock. So we tried to clarify that with some of the legislation as well. Victoria Rebeck works with our Deacon Studies program and with provisional membership, and she's going to address those issues with you.
I've got the old school laptop here instead of the mobile device. Kind of funny when laptops are old school. So provisional membership, as Meg mentioned, the evaluation criteria for that at that point is readiness to serve full-time in the annual conference as a provisional member. They need to be able to articulate their call either to deacon or elder, and we will talk about that a little more in a moment. They also have to undergo with you a doctrinal exam, and the DECOM at that point affirms that they see, would you help me with that? Thank you. The DECOM affirms that they see the leadership capacity in this candidate that's needed for the ministry they'll be doing. Requirements, education requirements is, for one, they have to have completed a bachelor's degree. And we've been getting questions about this in our office. There are graduate schools of theology that will sometimes accept as students into a master's program a student who has not completed a bachelor's degree. However, the Book of Discipline requires completion of a bachelor's degree. There are a limited number of exceptions to this, one being for some reason they were prevented from completing a bachelor's degree, another being the cultural background that may have made it difficult to complete a bachelor's degree, and there may have been one other. Do you remember what that is? It's in the Book of Discipline, however. But those would be rare situations. They do, in most cases, have to have completed a bachelor's degree. For their graduate education, at the point of approval for provisional membership, for elders, they have to have completed half of their MDiv, including half of the basic graduate theological studies. For deacons, they would have to have completed, if they're getting a master's degree from seminary, half of their master's degree from seminary, including half of their basic graduate theological studies. Or if that person becoming a deacon is going the route where they have a master's in a specialized field, they have completed that master's in that specialized field and half of their basic graduate theological studies. Okay. And also, of course, completion of written and oral doctrinal exam. So, general conference decisions. This is kind of a basic cleanup one. It had said that in the discipline that the basic graduate theological studies added up to 24 hours, but if you did the math, you realized it was actually 27 hours, and so that got corrected. And going back to explaining their call to deacon and elder, there's a new requirement now that people coming, I think, for provisional membership need to be able to describe both the elders' ministry and describe the deacon's ministry. Yeah. So not just the one that they're called to. For one thing, this clarifies or can help clarify their own sense of call, shows that they know that there are deacon and elders' orders, and you know that your clergy are going to help their people in their ministry settings with to discern their calls to ministry. And so they're going to need to know that we have two orders of ministry and what they're about. Okay. Let's pause.
Okay. Well, I've heard that there are some questions coming in. So before we switch over to talking about the deacons, I wanted to address questions related to candidacy, local pastor, and commissioning. So if we could toss up the slide with those questions, we'll try to address some of those. Or we can do it the old-fashioned way and people can stand up and ask. There they are. Is the PowerPoint? Yes, we are making all of our PowerPoints available. They will be posted as close to after the sessions as we can make that happen. Additionally, we are recording the plenary sessions, and they will be posted online through the BOM library within about 2 to 3 weeks. We know you need those rather quickly, so Good News TV will be working hard to make that happen for you. Candidates interviewing for certification at or near the end of their studies, so they are automatically eligible. How does a DECOM handle interviewing for fitness and readiness simultaneously? You're making two decisions when someone is coming, when a new candidate is coming to you and wants to receive that license rather quickly. They've completed the educational requirement, but before someone can receive a license for ministry, they need to become a certified candidate, which is going to include them talking about their call and being able to discern, talk about how they've discerned their call to the satisfaction of the district committee. That will also include your background checks, your credit checks, your psychological assessment. All of it has to be completed before they are certified. So you make sure that they hit those guideposts first, and then the DCOM makes the decision whether or not to certify them. If the DCOM decides to certify them, they can basically at the same time decide if that person is ready to serve as a local pastor. Do they meet the same kinds of qualifications to receive a license and have the same kind of skills that you would expect out of any other local pastor? So while those decisions can happen on the same day, it's a separate decision process for certification and for approval for licensing. Yes, when the discipline says, Shannon, when the discipline says that a local pastor must have completed course of study, if the local pastor has an MDiv, does this satisfy this requirement? Correct. And that is some of the legislation we didn't lift up here. There was a change in the discipline that the MDiv also will meet the qualifications for studies, educational studies, for local pastor. What about those who have served a number of years as lay supply? We all live under the current discipline, and it goes into effect January 1. So for those who are going to continue to serve as lay supply, you'll need to move them into that process for CLM or for licensing. There's no grandfather or grandmother clause in the new legislation that allows lay supply to continue serving in that capacity. Can the local pastor on DCOM be a retired local pastor? That's a really good question. I don't know. Retired local pastors, when local pastors are retired, if they're not serving, they do not have a license for ministry. So they're not a clergy member if they are not in an appointment. They can be lay. They would fulfill the lay category on the DCOM, but I don't know if they would fulfill the local pastor category if they're not serving. Did I hear Shannon say that a local pastor is not awarded their license until approved by the clergy session? Local pastors who are coming into an appointment at the regular conference year time, everything is approved by the clergy session. There's a question on the business of the annual conference report that lists all the local pastors whom your DCOM has approved and your BOM has recommended. And then the clergy session officially votes on that report. So it is a three-step process for someone to receive their license. And that happens through the business of the annual conference report. I would like more information about 324.6. Maybe.
There is provision in the discipline for an interim license if there is an appointment that is made between conference sessions, though. So, but it does then have to be approved by the conference session.
The question about 324.6, is that about the expansion of course of study? Or other parts of 324.6. You want to say more about it? So the statement up here that says, I would like more information about 324.6. Can someone speak to that in more detail?
You already answered my question.
Okay, thank you. You'll need to remind me what Judicial Council 1321 is. Whoever wrote that? We'll have to come back to that. Okay. Please go to the microphone.
Can you hear me? Thanks. It's the one that kind of clarified but didn't clarify the question regarding General Conference sets the standards and the annual conference is the basic body of the United Methodist Church, and so we get to determine at the annual conference level whether those standards have been met. So judicial counsel really didn't clarify that. So just wondering what y'all would say about that at GBHEM.
I would really need to read that decision before I can comment on that. Did you write that question? If you could put your name,
sure.
We'll come back to it, but I don't want to speak off the top of my head on that without reading the decision. Sorry.
Okay,
yeah. Okay. Okay, we're going to move on now to talking about deacons. Oh, I'm sorry. Did I miss one? Okay. Yeah, really? Okay. So how about this? Why don't we're going to move to provision to deacons right now. We can't get to all of these, right? So we'll do our best, but I do want to make sure we get the information presented, and we're cataloging these, so we'll come back and write your written responses, but we can't get to right away. So let's go to deacons.
There was a significant change for the 2016 discipline regarding deacons, regarding sacramental responsibility for deacons. As you may be aware, the current discipline does allow the bishop to give responsibility to a deacon to preside at the sacraments. And currently, an elder or a district superintendent has to ask permission on behalf of the deacon. So that is changed. That will no longer be part, starting in January, that will no longer be part of the process. Deacons and elders are equal. Elders aren't the boss over deacons, although they might supervise them possibly in a situation. So therefore, one of the changes is if a deacon feels like in their ministry setting, there's a reason for them to need sacramental responsibility, the deacon has a direct conversation with the bishop about that. The change reads as follows. For the sake of extending the mission and ministry of the church and offering the means of grace to the world, the resident bishop of the annual conference in which the deacon is appointed, so they may be a member of another conference but appointed in a different one, they would ask the bishop in the conference where they are appointed, may authorize the deacon to preside at the celebration of the sacraments, that means both the Eucharist and baptism. Presiding at the celebration of the sacraments involves taking responsibility to lead the gathering community in celebrating baptism and Holy Communion, as I just said. So it remains the bishop's decision. And the idea is, again, extending the mission and ministry of the church. So, again, it's the bishop's job to interpret that. If I can dare say this, I think it's not an issue about the convenience of an elder, which is another reason why I think the language was changed. But it is about extending the mission and ministry of the church. But this is between the deacon and the bishop. That's really the most significant change to the discipline related to deacons.
We'll take a couple more questions as Hero is making her way forward. Yes, will GBHEM resource the new 8-year assessment? We are actually going to spend time on Thursday morning, about 30, 45 minutes, talking with you all about that. And we do have plans to provide resources and help annual conferences have that conversation. If you can't retire, why is there a BSC question about people listed as retired local pastors? Okay. Because we really love forms and data, right? There is a In order for a local pastor to receive an appointment after they reach mandatory retirement age or retire for whatever reason, the Board of Ordained Ministry needs to recognize them as a retired local pastor, and that means that they have made adequate progress in the course of study. So we have that category as a place where those who are qualified, if the bishop desires and the district committee approves, that they can receive an appointment during retirement. So that's why that category is there. Yes, yes, Jane.
Can I ask a follow-up question to that?
Yeah.
How do you determine what is adequate progress?
Did you see how quickly she turned to make me come up? The discipline requires that full-time local pastors take 4 course of study courses a year, and part-time pastors take 2 courses a year. But then it also states that full-time local pastors have 8 years to take it to complete the course of study, and that part-time local pastors have 12 years. So if you do the math and the 20 courses, there is the possibility that if there's some health or other reasons, that the Board of Ordained Ministry can allow local pastors to take less than the required courses. But although we don't recommend it, I mean, it's usually particular special circumstance. So it really is up to the board to look at the courses that have been taken, and if a local pastor has adequately fulfilled the disciplinary requirements or gotten permission from the board to lengthen out that educational process. So in essence, it's really up to the board using the requirements as set up in the discipline. I hope that's. My understanding is that if they're appointed in that interim position, that they can have the sacramental authority at that time. I mean, we make decisions about the clergy status all the time in different ways between clergy sessions, and then they're sort of voted on and approved at the clergy session following. So it would be when the appointment is made, is my understanding.
At what does a person need to be serving full time as a local pastor in order to apply for provisional membership, or is part time permissible? I believe it's a local pastor who has satisfied all the requirements for local pastors moving toward provisional membership. Once they, and if they receive provisional membership or associate membership, if they choose to go that direction, they must be prepared to serve as a provisional member in your annual conference and meet all the standards that you have set for provisional membership. Should bivocational pastors seeking ordination be required to serve or state willingness to serve full-time? We do have allowances in our discipline to serve less than full-time, so I don't know why a bivocational pastor would have to declare that they are willing to serve full-time. That is a conversation your board and your cabinet need to have about expectations of bivocational pastors and standards for ministry within your annual conference. The discipline, I can say, though, doesn't prohibit less than full-time service. Okay? We'll turn now to looking at the standards for ordination and full membership.
So, in terms of ordination and full membership, when we evaluate a provisional member for full membership, we are looking at 2 major criteria. Whether a provisional member has demonstrated that he or she is growing in effectiveness as a deacon or as an elder in their appointment setting, and whether the provisional member is ready to assume a lifetime commitment to the responsibilities of membership in the annual conference. In terms of a requirement, to be ordained as deacon or elder, all candidates need to fulfill educational requirements in the Book of Discipline. He or she needs minimum 2 years full-time service
as a provisional member. However, they cannot stay more than 8 years as a provisional member. So that's the limit. They need to complete residence in ministry successfully. Candidates need to demonstrate effectiveness in ministry to the satisfaction of the Board of Ordained Ministry. So your annual conference has the norm of what is good for your annual conference. So General Conference Decisions 2016. General Conference deleted repetitive ordination questions in paragraph 330 and paragraph 335. And you have hand out the numbers, but it didn't spell out, so I'm going to tell you the question, and I quote, "How has the practice of ministry enriched your understanding of the meaning and the significance of the sacrament?" So that question has been deleted. And this is a major change. Voting majority percentage changed to a consistent 3/4 majority for all major decisions with all groups. For certification, first-time licensing, associate membership, provisional membership, and full membership. So our life is a little easier, right? Okay. Thank you.
And in the spirit of full disclosure, I said this yesterday in the candidacy registrar's workshop, the intent of the 3/4 majority legislation was to make that consistent across all votes. However, because you know how the discipline's written and there's subpoints here and other paragraphs there, we did miss two places. I'm looking at Amy Wagner because you were part of that conversation. When the BOM votes to send a candidate for full membership, or it's either provisional, I think it's provisional membership, to the clergy session, that still reads 2/3, okay? And when the DCOM votes to send someone for associate membership to the BOM, that still reads 2/3. So we have asked the publishing house and the Committee on Correlation and Review if they will look at that and make that adjustment. We'll see what they say when the new discipline is printed. So that, just so you know, there are just those inconsistencies. Yeah, it is when the BOM sends someone to the clergy session to be approved for provisional membership, I believe. The discipline will still read a 2/3 majority, which it is what it currently is. We had intended to change everything to 3/4, and that just got left out of the legislation package. It was an oversight. And then also where the DCOM would vote to send someone to interview for associate membership still is listed as not the 3/4 majority vote. But we've asked, and I'm going to see what happens when the new discipline is printed, and we'll, you know, if those changes are made, we'll make sure everybody does know about that. Amy, yes, you want to go to the mic, please?
Would that be a place, if those changes are not made, where annual conferences can, in a sense, add to and make the decision that they're going to use a 3/4 across the board? It more than meets.
Yeah, right. Where I fall on that, and again, I defer to the bishop on these kinds of matters of interpretation, but I think we have to be careful when we start changing vote percentages when the vote says shall. Yeah, so if it says shall be a 2/3 and you're changing it to a 3/4, I mean, what's to prevent a conference from changing it to 95% or 100% even? So proceed with caution on that. That hasn't been tested, so proceed with caution. Yeah. Or don't proceed with caution and see if it will get tested. That could be fun. Yeah. So do you want to put some questions back up, see if we can circle back to some things before we move to the next portion? And maybe delete some of the ones we've already talked about. Did paragraph 324.1 remove the 12-year requirement for candidacy in the 2016 discipline? No, that is still there. We just added some language, I hope, to clarify that local pastors who are serving as clergy don't fall into that candidacy 12-year requirement anymore. But the 12-year limit on candidacy is still there for people who are not local pastors. Yes, we will emphasize these changes to the voting. We're doing it with you, and we hope you will do this with your boards and your district committees when you change them. The language will be changed in the new business of the annual conference report so that your conference secretaries and people who work on completing that report know that as well. Victoria, paragraph 328, is the deacon's authorization to preside ongoing or does it need annual renewal? And then there's one other one up there about a deacon.
You know what? The new language doesn't address that. So, again, that would be between the bishop and the deacon, I believe.
And then the next question.
Oh, if deacon receives sacramental privilege from a bishop, is it tied to the ministry context in which it's being sought? Which I think is the case currently, but again, that is not in the new legislation if you read it literally. So that'll be a bishop interpretation.
Okay, example, 11 out of 15 votes in favor of a candidate is 73.3. Discipline says 75. Can the percentage be rounded up? No. Read Robert's rules. Why I say no is because that's what Robert's rules say. When it's a three-fourths, you must have three-fourths or more. Robert's rules does not allow you to round up. This did come up recently, so if your board needs to give numbers to your district committees, because you need to have consistency. You cannot have one district committee saying 11-15 round up and another district committee saying 11 out of 15 no. So I would strongly suggest as your boards that you send numbers to your DCOMs. You know, if you have 9 people there, this is what 3/4 is. If you have 10 people there, this is what 3/4 is, so that there is no question about that. Did you skip change to paragraph 331 ABLC clarification? I'm not sure what that question means. Oh, okay. Oh, yeah, okay. The language, what that was about, we took all, paragraph 344 is the language on extension ministry for elders and associate pastors, local pastors. And deacons were listed in 344 as well. So we removed all of the deacon language and put it into 331. So that's what that is about. Right, and that is exactly. That is to help reinforce that deacons are appointed to appointments beyond the local church, while elders, associate pastors, local pastors are appointed to extension ministry. And we wanted to get them out of the same paragraph in the discipline. That's why we did that, yes. What is being assessed at the DCOM recommendation interview? I assume by the context of the question that that means when you are assessing whether a candidate is ready to go to provisional membership, right? That's my assumption just based on that context. You are assessing if they are ready to be a provisional member in your annual conference. At this point, you know the district committee knows the candidate better than the Board of Ordained Ministry does. So are they at a place where they can complete the paperwork, they know the doctrine of the United Methodist Church, are willing to abide by our polity, have they completed the educational requirements required of a provisional member, and are they ready to take on full-time or a point of service within your conference? The BOM, speaking as a BOM member, I know we meet candidates coming to us, and you've never met this person, you have 30 to 90 minutes with a candidate, and you have to decide, is this person ready for provisional membership? So that DCOM recommendation is very critical in helping the BOM know if somebody is ready for provisional membership. Regarding the sacramental questions, yes, in paragraphs 330 and 335, it simply was the repetitive question that was deleted. The question remains. We just took out the one that repeated the first question. If the person is a local pastor, does the provisional member 8-year clock still apply? Provisional membership is still limited to 8 years. I'm not sure I understand. Once someone becomes a provisional member, they're no longer a local pastor. They serve by virtue of a license, but their classification is provisional membership, not licensed local pastor. And so, yes, that is still limited to 8 years. Well, yeah, there's many ways for someone over age 72 to respond to a call to ministry, many ways. However, they cannot be a certified candidate to do that. So they can be certified lay ministers. They can serve as lay supply for less than a year. I know. But the reason why people cannot enter certified candidacy at age 72 really is our mandatory retirement age. You cannot retire when you can't enter a process when you're older than the mandatory retirement age. I don't know if there's a way we can work around that. Maybe we can look at that. That's becoming more and more of a question as people have longer retirements and are willing to serve in different capacities longer in life. So that may be something our denomination needs to address down the road. Will the DECOM annual renewal for licensing be a 3/4 vote? I believe it will, but that is my opinion. The reason I say that is when you look at paragraph, it is 315 or 316, and the new language reads, in all cases when someone is licensed, they must have received the 3/4 majority vote. And it's just listed down the line from the DECOM and from the clergy session. So I believe that that renewal is going to be a 3/4. Again, that is my opinion. So there you have it. I'd be willing to hear somebody else's opinion on that. But read 315, or it's 315 or 316. So read that. We're going to move now into some things around conference relations and mentoring. So if there are any more process questions, we'll turn to that. David Martinez works in specialized theological education, works with the National Hispanic Plan, the Native American Ministry Plan, and a host of other things. He's going to talk with us about mentoring and mentors.
Hi. I know you probably exhausted all this information that we have given you, but I think that this area is very important. Mentoring is essential. Let me say again, mentoring is essential. We lose candidates because they don't have good mentors. So let me tell you a little bit of some of the things that we are doing. Part of the candidacy and ordination process in the monitoring and the mentoring that goes along with the application process. Providing well-trained gift mentors gives candidates and clergy the opportunity to better discern their call and to sharpen their ministry skills during their early years of appointment. The conference is responsible for selecting, training, and assigning mentors to work with candidates and clergy throughout their discernment and application process. Candidacy mentors are assigned to work with those who apply for certified candidacy and candidates who have not yet been licensed or accepted into provisional membership. Clergy mentors are assigned to work with local pastors who are enrolled in course of study and with provisional members. The cabinet recommends possible mentors and the Board of Ordained Ministry selects and trains mentors. This is another place where the cabinet and the Board of Ordained Ministry collaborate in this process. Sometimes we talk about where do they collaborate. This is the opportunity of the collaboration. Let's talk about some of the responsibilities of the mentors. Once again, candidacy mentoring is a collaborative effort among the district superintendent, the vocational discernment coordinator, the DCOM, and the conference candidacy register. Clergy mentor for local pastors are assigned through the DCOM and the district superintendent, while the Board of Ordained Ministry and the district superintendents work together to assign mentors for provisional members. Any associate members or ordained deacons or elder may serve as a candidate or clergy mentor. Likewise, and part-time or full-time local pastors who have completed the course of study may serve as a candidacy or clergy mentor. Some of the changes or decision made in the General Conference in mentoring is 348.1b. The General Conference made two decisions that are related to mentoring. One, part-time local pastors who have completed the course of study may now serve as clergy mentors. They were already allowed to serve as a candidacy mentors. The allowance to also serve as a clergy mentor is new this quadrennium. Board of Ordained Ministry and Annual Conference are now being encouraged to implement and assign local pastors to clergy mentoring groups whenever possible. We have seen demonstrated success during the provisional membership period through the use of mentoring groups. Additionally, candidate mentoring groups are now being developed and received positively in most annual conference. The General Conference wanted local pastors to also have the opportunity to benefit from participating in clergy mentoring groups. So now legislation was passed in order to encourage the use of clergy mentoring groups for local pastors whenever possible.
Just to follow up on that question about the licensing for local pastors, if you look at the new language, it's in paragraph 315.6. And it does read, in every case, those who are licensed shall have, and it lists the background checks, the certified candidacy, the notarized statement. And then it says, been approved by a, this is the new language, 3/4 majority vote of the BOM, and then the next point, D, received approval by a 3/4 majority vote of the clergy session. So that's why I say when it says in every case, that's why I do believe it's going to be for renewals as well. In the area of conference relations, the General Conference passed three pretty critical pieces of legislation. These are changes to less than full-time appointment, to transfers of United Methodist clergy who are provisional or ordained members, and then transitional leave. Less than full-time has changed substantially. I would encourage you to read that language that is in your handout. Read it carefully. There are now three categories under which people can serve in a less than full-time capacity. Limit itinerancy is a new category, and this is for any associate member, provisional, or full member, elder. This is for elders, who declares that forever, whatever reason, their itinerancy in the conference temporarily needs to be limited. By them acknowledging that, they acknowledge that the bishop may not have a full-time or even a part-time appointment available for them. The bishop is not required to provide a full-time appointment for the clergy if one is not available and acceptable and in an acceptable geographical area. This is a practice that has been going on in some annual conferences, and some of the delegates and people working to put this legislation together have come out of annual conferences where elders do sign a form acknowledging this if, for whatever reason, their itinerancy must be limited for a time. So I believe this legislation is more of a grassroots process than coming from some other places. Section 2, clergy initiated, is there's very little change to that. That's what we already have in place for clergy who are serving in less than full time, and it's typically limited to some kind of appointment setting that's less than full time. Now, Section 3 is new as well, and there has been a lot of discussion about this one. This is Section 338.3 now states that the bishop may initiate less than full time appointment with or without consent of the associate full member or provisional member elder. Yeah, that's a shift, isn't it? Yes, that is. We obviously, this is new language. This hasn't happened yet. This hasn't been tested if and when it may be tested by the Judicial Council. But what it reads right now is the bishop may initiate less than full-time appointment for missional purposes in the annual conference. The things that are still required, if this is to happen, this requires cabinet and BOM recommendation and a two-thirds approval of the clergy session. The bishop must notify the clergy of the change to less than full-time service at least 90 days before the termination of their current appointment. So read that, talk with your bishop about this, see how your conference is or might approach working with this, but that's a big change for us. The second conference relations change then has to do with transfers. We talked about this a little earlier this morning. The General Conference added a requirement that when a provisional or an ordained United Methodist clergy transfer from one conference to the other, that transfer must go through recommendation of the Board of Ordained Ministry and approval of the clergy session before the transfer is final. This has eliminated that bishop-to-bishop transfer process that has been in place for United Methodist clergy up until now. And then with 347, the recognition of orders paragraph has been moved from the 348 to 347, which means that ordination credentials are recognized upon full membership. The intent of that was to try to clarify that. So because of that, everything 348 and up is going down one number. So all your leaves, paragraphs, and stuff are going to shift down one number. There are a couple of changes in the transitional leave paragraph as well. This mainly affects elders. Last quadrennium, transitional leave was available for deacons moving between appointments or for elders transferring from extension ministry back into the local church. With the new discipline, transitional leave is available for deacons or elders or associate members who are simply between appointments. So an elder moving from the local church to extension ministry or from one local church quickly into another local church that needs a status, transitional leave is an option for you to use. Did I hear something? Oh, okay. Okay. Transitional leave, then we clarified, is limited to a 12-month period. Questions there? Do we have questions at this point? We're getting to a place where we've already talked about the BOM and the DECOM paragraphs this morning, so I want to pause and see if people need clarification or have anything to ask at this time. Yes, if you could please go to the microphone. And if you all could pull up are there any questions on the, okay, there's not, great.
Okay. So it says transfers are to be made on the recommendation of the Board of Ordained Ministry. What structure within the Board of Ordained Ministry is supposed to handle that, or is that up to the board? So we have been told at times that it's the Conference Relations Committee, at other times we've been told it's the Executive Committee, and there's been battles back and forth about that.
A process decision for your board, and what you've stated, some boards do have a transfer committee, some boards do assign it to conference relations, some boards put it through the executive committee, some set up an interview team to deal with specific instances. Process is up to you.
With regards to transfer again, our clergy session meets just once a year.
Right.
So what's the process for somebody trying to transfer mid-year? Do they just say status quo, or do they are they appointed in a local church?
There's a couple different options. They could serve as someone in, I believe, they can transfer ad interim with approval of the executive committee, and then the transfer becomes permanent once the clergy session approves it.
Okay.
Does that help?
So it's still initiated between bishops then. You're saying, you had said that, so that still stands then? The conversation between two bishops saying, hey, I have somebody here who can be
the
serving
bishops,
in your...
I mean, certainly the bishops can consult, and we do, and we encourage that. But for the transfer to take place, it has to go through the executive committee and the Board of Ordained Ministry. So if it's an ad interim decision of the executive committee to allow the person to move into the conference, and then it becomes ratified at the following clergy session.
All right.
Yeah.
Under 347, 6, mm-hmm. that you noted. So therefore, the recognition of orders paragraph, therefore, provisionals would serve under their current credentials mm-hmm. until full membership.
Right.
Would there ever be a point that a local pastor then would be their past credentials or current credentials would be recognized and they would serve? We would recognize their orders and let them be a local pastor.
They wouldn't be serving under 347, then they'd be serving under the licensing paragraph, I believe.
Okay.
Yeah.
Right. Okay.
Yeah, I believe. Amy?
I want to follow up to the question asked over here. The transfer is for conference membership, so a bishop could still allow an appointment into another annual conference and appoint that person mid-year.
Oh, sure.
And they wouldn't have to transfer their conference membership
right.
until clergy session. So I don't know that there would need to be an interim.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean,
decision.
I think there's a number of different ways
yeah.
to handle
but that appointment
that
business is still bishop to bishop without us mm-hmm. getting involved.
Yeah, until the transfer happens, right?
If they want to transfer.
If they want to. Yes. Thank you, Amy. Okay, I have already talked with you about the BOM and the DCOM paragraphs. I'm including these in this presentation just so you have them for your reference. We want to close out today by talking about decisions around coaching. So hero coaching and continuing formation, and Hero's going to talk with you about those. Y'all are doing great for an afternoon lunch session that talks about legislation. Give yourselves a hand.
The General Board of Higher Education and Ministry has been nurturing clergy coaches with certification from the International Coach Federation since 2013. As a response to increasing demand for coaching for pastoral leadership, we have produced about 30 associate and professional certified United Methodist clergy coaches. These clergy coaches are committed to serving the church with their coaching skills. 2016 General Conference adopted these legislations, coaching to be one of the pathways to transform urban congregations, the strengthening the Black Church for the 21st century to use coaching to transform and sustain vital Black congregations and Black pastors in cross-racial and cross-cultural appointment. Study of Ministry Commission recommended to use a series of coaching for clergy assessment. And study of ministry also proposed to strengthen the requirement for lifelong learning and coaching for clergy for educational and spiritual growth. So GBHM recommends that the Board of Ordained Ministry utilizes these clergy coaches for developing effective clergy leadership during the ordination process. Please visit umccybercampus.com. It's all one word, umccybercampus.com, to review the bios of United Methodist Church clergy coaches. Thank you.
All right, before we close, the eight-year assessment, the final disciplinary change that I want to highlight today is this new requirement for an in-depth assessment of clergy every 8 years. This is for all clergy. It is a six-month assessment process that is to happen every 8 years. Guess who gets to lead it and develop it? The cabinet! It's a part. It is a partnership between the cabinet, the boards, and the orders and fellowship. The timeline for implementing this new process is January 1st, 2020. As Hero mentioned, coaching, assessments, retreats, renewals are all part of that process. It's a lengthy piece of legislation that I've given you today so you can read through it. We're not going to really get into talking about this today because we will have ample time in the plenary session on Thursday morning to discuss this. But it is the new paragraph 349.3. It's a recommendation that came out of the Study of Ministry Commission, and it's a partnership with you all and with your bishops and your cabinets in your orders chairs. Yes, good luck. It'll be great. And GBHEM is, we're looking forward to being involved in this conversation with you all and seeing how things could develop for our denomination.